In this video, we are going to discuss about the professional skills and how to write them in an examination. So, professional skills carry 20 marks of the total examination marks, and there are like totally 5 professional skills which are there, and the marking of 20 marks is spread across these 5 skills. So, it's not like they are like equally allocated in terms of 4, 4, 4 and 4 and 4, okay. Somewhere it can be a little bit higher and a little bit lower. So, skepticism in some exam can be 6, commercial acumen can be like 2, so analysis can be like 4. So, it can be like a little bit varying, that's what they say. Mark weightings across the skills will vary. So, we won't have the 20 marks split into all the 5 skills in an equal manner. So, this is about the professional skills. In each question, they will ask you a specific professional skill. So, there won't be a combination of 2 professional skills asked in the same question. Each question will specifically mention only 1 professional skill. Okay. So, we'll move on to more detail of this. So, we'll start from the first professional skill, which is called as a communication. It includes the keywords inform, persuade and to clarify. These are the various communication styles which may be like required in terms of communication skills. So, you might be asked to draft a letter, an email, a briefing note, a memo, a report, presentation slides with notes, visual aids such as a heat map or a stakeholder matrix, or briefing notes, briefing papers, working notes, press release, and sometimes even a project initiation document. So, ACCA has given a format of how these documents should be in one of their PDF documents, which you will find if you Google it. Letter should be like this. It should have a to, from, date, subject. It should start with dear, and it should end with the name of the author. So, you are the author of the letter. So, you can have it as you, the word you. In terms of a report, this is the structure. You have to, from, the subject of the report, a small introduction for two to three lines, the main body of the report. For example, the answer for your question would actually comprise here, and finally you would have to write a conclusion. So, based upon the discussion of the main body, you write a conclusion. Again, conclusion should be for 2 to 3 sentences. Sometimes you might be asked to give a slide and a note. So, a slide is the presentation slide, that is the PPT that we normally use. So, they might ask you to replicate that. So, if they ask you to write a presentation slide, this is how you do it. You put a slide heading, then you write bullet point 1, 2, 3. Okay. Then to explain this bullet point, the bullet point is in terms of just 2-3 words only here. So, these 2-3 words should be accompanied by a paragraph. So, this one point should be explained in 2 to 3 sentences in the notes section. So, this is separate and this is separate. So, you just write the bullet points here, you give the explanation notes here, and then you have the press release. Press release is when a company releases any document or any information to the press, to the newspapers or to the media. So, the format is you have the heading called as press release, the date and time, the actual answer of yours that has to be written here, okay, and it should be like after ending, at the end of ending, it should have for more information, press only, the PR contact name, phone number and email. You just need to write these, you don't need to write any actual phone number or email ID. So, you just need to end your answer like this. So, what should be the tone of it? Okay, see, the tone should be written not in an answer way, it should be written how the company would actually give a press release, okay. So, it should be like convincing, it should be like persuading the intended audience. So, your answer should not be in terms of just putting your knowledge into the answer paper. It's about thinking in terms that you are writing an actual press release to be released. Okay. So, the tone of writing should be very persuading. Okay. So, that's how you have to write it. Or they might ask you sometimes in terms of the PID. So, PID is project initiation document. So, usually this document is accompanied whenever a project is about to be started. So, what you do is here, you can actually write the answer in terms of paragraphs after paragraphs. But if you're going to create a PID, the PID structure is this. Okay, the PID's structure is this. So once you use this structure, your answer would be much more neat. Okay, so if they ask you PID, you have to prepare it in this manner. Okay, don't worry about the rectangle or the square boxes here. They are not required to be presented in the examination. So we'll just have a few examples of how it works. So we'll have for the communication skill. See, one of the communication skill is here. You have to prepare one slide with appropriate notes. Okay, so this is one of the communication skill. So this is what you have to do. So it is about the presentation style. So prepare a slide with notes. Okay, this is a presentation slide. Or if you go through this question, it tells you prepare a briefing paper for the CFO to allow him to address the wider finance team to explain how corporate reporting using the IR framework provides more relevant information for SmartFare's shareholders. So this question is about the CFO. So you have to prepare a briefing paper for the CFO. The CFO is going to use your briefing paper to explain the finance team that why IR framework or integrated reporting framework could be useful. Okay, so it's all about the CFO trying to convince his finance team that IR is a better framework. So your tone of answer should be in terms of persuading, convincing, okay, buying in that finance team. So that's how the presentation should be. So the mark is reserved for the tone of communication, not only that you are going to write a briefing paper. Okay, it's for the tone. So communication skills can be tested in two ways. One is presentation style, a letter, a memo, a briefing paper, a slide, or the tone of communication, whom you are addressing, what you have to address, should you convince them, should you argue with them, that kind of tone of communication might also be tested. This is the grid which ACCA has given for each of these answers. So a student who has to score good marks in this communication skill for this particular question will score 2 marks if he is going to write this point. So the candidate provided slides and notes that communicated the main facts about integrated thinking to the board, and the notes were structured in a way that was both informative to the audience and would have been convincing to the shareholders about the merit of adopting IR. So this is how your communication skills mark is like reserved. So next we'll move on to the commercial acumen skill. So commercial acumen skill has three more skills within it. One is called as demonstrate awareness, use judgment, and show insight. So how is this mark? So how can we get this commercial acumen mark? See, it's a very simple and straightforward way. You should have a general awareness of the real world businesses. So you should read newspapers, you should read newspaper articles, magazine articles, and you have to surf the internet regarding businesses. Okay, how they are conducted, what problems they face. Okay, so you have to apply the SBL syllabus into and search them in the Google, like what happens with companies in terms with this syllabus. Okay, so if you have an internal control in your syllabus, you apply, you type internal control in Google and find out like what are the various issues have occurred in companies when internal control fails, when corporate governance fails, when risk management fails. Okay, so you have to find out like what are the problems companies faces if any of the syllabus matter in your SBL fails. Okay, to apply in the real world, it's about getting involved in the syllabus and trying to find out how it would work in the real world. Okay, so once you keep reading, your mind will grab a lot of real world issues, problems, applications. Okay, then you can, then when you write an answer, your answer, the way you write an answer would be actually different. Okay, so it's not only going to reflect the theory and textbook kind of knowledge, but also the real world knowledge. See, that is what commercial acumen requires. Okay, so we'll have a example like how commercial acumen applies in a real world question, in a SBL question. So this question is from June 2019. They asked to which evaluates the effectiveness of internal control systems at the company, okay, particularly on the procurement side, and recommends control improvements to rectify the identified area of concern. The skill is commercial acumen. So what we have to do? See, the answer that we have to write is, we have to first check whether how good the internal control system of the company is. Then we have to tell the recommendations to improve the internal control system. This is the first part of this. What are the internal control systems in the company? That we can find out through our textbook knowledge. If we have textbook knowledge, we can easily apply that knowledge to the question, to the case, and get some points, and we can write. But in order to recommend which control systems have to be improved, how they have to be like rectified, you should have a better understanding of the real world implications. So you should have an idea of what are the ways in which real world companies are approaching internal control, what problems they have faced, where it usually fails. If you have that idea, you can take that real world knowledge and textbook knowledge and the case knowledge, and then you apply it on this answer. Okay, you mix all these three and write an answer, you will get your commercial acumen. You are not required to quote, okay, it's not required to quote any company saying that this company is having an internal control issue in the real world. That is not required. But whether you have studied something beyond the textbook or not, that can be easily identified when you write an answer. Okay, so you have to write things which are beyond the textbook. Okay, you have to apply your commercial business knowledge in this question. So that's where commercial acumen mark is reserved. So in terms of mark allocation, see, the candidate correctly used the information contained in the report, so that is the case information, to evaluate the internal control problems, so this is the textbook knowledge, and to provide sensible recommended control improvements, this is the real world knowledge. So they have applied all the three knowledges. So that's where the mark is reserved. Okay, so we'll move on to the next professional skill, which is called as the analysis. It has three subcomponents. One is called investigate, inquire, consider. So what do you do in an analysis question? In an analysis question, you have to ask three or four times why. The question why. Why is this happening? Why has this is happening? Okay, you have to keep on asking this question. For example, we'll put it like this. A question asks you, why is the sales of the company falling? Okay, can you analyze it? How do you analyze? Number one, the sales of the product is falling. Why? It's because the product quality is not good. Why is the product quality not good? It's because the raw materials are of not good quality. Why the raw materials are of not good quality? Because we don't have a reliable supplier. Why we don't have a reliable supplier? Because we are not paying promptly. Okay, so if we promptly pay our suppliers, they would give us good quality raw material at a correct time. Okay, so can you understand the logic between this frame? The problem started with why the sales are going down, and the root cause of the problem was that the material supplier is not supplying at the proper time and of good quality. Okay, and why it is that? It is because payment has not been paid promptly. So if you want good quality, if you want higher sales, the actual problem is pay the supplier promptly. Okay, so this is what analysis is. It's about digging deeper and deeper and deeper, and you try to find out the root cause of the problem. That is where analysis mark is built up. So you can go through this question. This question is again from June 2019 exam. It asks you, determine why smartware appears to be performing so well in this particular country compared to Noria. Analysis skill is required. Why? Why is this company performing well in a particular country? It might be because of the laborers there. Why? Because the laborers are effectively performing, because they are highly motivated. Why are they highly motivated? Because they have been given lifetime employment. So why is it not working in Noria? In Noria, if we give lifetime employment to people, people are becoming lazy, they are not working. So the logic is this. If we give lifetime employment opportunity to a set of people in a country, they feel that it's their company and they work better. If you give the same lifetime employment in another country, they feel that it's my company, then why should I work at all? Okay, that is the difference in approach here. So your job is to dig deeper and find what's the root cause of this effect. Okay, it's all about the cause and effect. Okay, cause is what causing the problem and effect is the result. So you have to determine why this company is successful. That is actually the effect. Your job is to find out the root cause of this. Okay, and this is where analysis skills is built up. So if you want to see how mark has been like given here, the candidate has represented a report which has identified and used the most important and relevant data to analyze SmartWare's strategic position in the Southland market. See how it has been written. Why this company is performing so well in a particular country, they have analyzed the relevant data, okay, and they have and important data, and they have given a report. Okay, so you have to dig deeper and get the important data and the relevant data which is causing the effect. Okay, so that's what you have to do. Okay, we'll move on to the next skill. Okay, this is a very interesting kind of skill which is called as a skepticism. Skepticism has three components. One is probing, question, and challenge. So if you have a skepticism question, what you should do? See, in a skepticism question, usually like there are like two ways they would give you. They would give first a financial analysis, or they would give a statement from a person. Okay, if they are going to give a numerical analysis, they will give you an answer, something like an NPV analysis answer. But some numbers would have been like assumed, would be little bit wrong here and there. The assumption would have been like too pessimistic, too optimistic, too unrealistic. Okay, you should find out like whether this NPV analysis is right, whether the not the numerical computations, okay, whether the assumptions are accepted. Okay, you have to question things. Okay, so you're not going to accept any analysis on its face value. You're going to dig deeper, and you're not going to believe that these are true, and you're going to find out the real information. Okay, this is somewhere similar to analysis, but the difference between analysis and skepticism is, skepticism is we are not believing anything on the face value. Okay, in analysis we believe that things are on the face value, but we still dig deeper to find out the root cause analysis. But in skepticism we are not believing anything on the face value. Okay, so if skepticism can also be tested in terms of the statements from a person. For example, marketing director might say that products cannot be sold because they are of a very poor quality, and they are not being available at a proper time. There's no support from the company, that's why sales is down. Should you believe him? The answer is no. He might be biased. You have to find out why is he giving a statement like that. Is he not responsible for any of the fall in sale? Okay, should we blame him for something? Is anything wrong from his side? Okay, are all his statement is right? You have to verify it, then you have to come to a conclusion. This is where skepticism skill is interesting and gets you the mark. So if you go through this question, see, evaluate the strategic and ethical implications to SmartWare of the planned shop closure in Noria and the withdrawal from Centrum. Mark is skepticism. Okay, so this company wants to close down some shops. Okay, you have to find out, does closing shop really help the company? Is closing shop the solution for the company? Will it reduce the loss, or can we do something else to improve the profitability here? So somewhere we analyze in terms of the more than what this being like actually said. Okay, so that's where skepticism mark is reserved for. Professional skills marks are available for applying skepticism by probing deeply into underlying issues and problems that may arise from this strategic decision beyond what is immediately apparent. On the surface level or the face value level, something is apparent, but beneath it, what is required, that you have to probe. So the mark is reserved for probing, challenging, and questioning. So this is another skepticism skill. Okay, the professional skill that is required is skepticism. You have to evaluate the marketing department's NPV analysis that supports the CDMS investment, questioning any underlying assumptions made. Your job to find out like where NPV analysis is like wrong. Okay, what assumptions they have made, whether they are like realistic, whether they are like pessimistic, okay, or optimistic, whether it's achievable. So you try to find out these information. Okay. If you look here, the marks are here. The candidate's report identified all of major omissions and errors from the NPV computation. Some numbers which have to be added have not been added, and there are also some errors in the NPV computation. The candidate challenged the main incorrect underlying assumptions. So the underlying assumptions which are wrong he has identified coherently, logically and convincingly. Okay. So it's also about the tone in which you write. You argue, it's an argument that the NPV is wrong. Okay, you are arguing that NPV is wrong. Once you argue it, you have to argue strongly. Okay, argue strongly based upon the facts. So you will be like getting your skepticism skills mark. So we have come to the last section of a professional skills mark. It's called as evaluate. So evaluate is all about assess, estimate and appraise. Again, we'll look at the June 2019 question paper. It says analyze the environment in which smartware operates. So the environment usually refers to the PESTEL analysis, okay, and it requires an evaluation skill. So what you should do for an evaluation skill? See, evaluation skill works in this manner. You have to identify all the points which are both positive and negative to the company. Okay, you are not trying to be very, you are not trying to be optimistic or pessimistic. You just get the facts out of the case. Okay, if it's like more positive points, write them all, the positive points, less positive point, negative points are there, write them. Your job is to just identify. Okay, you are not trying to be on the cautious side or anything. You just get all the points from the case. Okay, in terms of the factors which affect the smartware company. So you get all the PESTEL factors from the case and you jot them down. Okay. And finally you take a call. Okay. The call should be in terms of a balanced view. Balanced view is when there are like many positive points, you say that the company operates in a very positive environment and which is like very conducive for the company. If there are like many negative points, then you say the company operates in a very negative environment. Therefore, the company might not be able to make a huge amount of profit. So your answer is very balanced here. You're not positive and you're not like optimistic or pessimistic. You're not doubting anything or doing anything. Your job is to just collect the facts and finally give a very balanced view of about the case. Okay. So that's where evaluation mark is reserved. Okay. So here is a summary of all the professional skills. It's very difficult for you to memorize all these what we discussed in the video and then apply it in an examination. So what I have done is I have given it in terms of very small sentence which you can remember easily. So communication skills, the mark is reserved for the presentation style or the tone of communication. In terms of commercial acumen, you have to read business newspapers and magazines and internet and give a answer which combines both the textbook knowledge and the real world knowledge. So give practical answer exam information. Skepticism is you are not going to accept anything which is on the face value. You are going to question the assumptions, the ideas, the thoughts and calculations. Okay, you are a little bit pessimistic here. Okay, you are a little bit you want to probe the real truth. So what is analysis? You try to find the truth. You ask the question why. You go to the root cause of any problem or any situation. Evaluation is you try to identify the both the plus point and the minus point of an issue and then you give a balanced opinion, balanced answer. Okay, so that is what the summary of the professional skills. So thank you very much. We'll move on to the next section.